Make sure you unmute, please.
Hey, Phil, Andrew Kahn here. Good to talk to you. You can hear me, yes?
Yes, I hear you.
All right, good, thanks. I mean, I'm sure in your career, you've had times where you had a team that, you know, the public thought maybe would be better than they were, you know, at this point in the season. Obviously, you guys can still get there, but I guess, is that something you have to combat or talk with the guys about? Like, forget what people thought we were. Like, this is what we are. This is what we can become. We can get better every day. And I don't know. Is that a factor?
I think that if you focus on it early, then you have to focus on it late, so to speak, like this year. But the fact that people would say, well, you're the preseason favorite, that's based on last year.
Right.
It's not based on you know, what is actually happening in the gym. Same with individual players. Like preseason player of the year, that's for, and I don't mean this in a smart way, but that's for fans to talk about. So if you as a coach every year address, do you believe this? We got picked sixth preseason. Then you have to acknowledge it when this year we were co-favorite or a trendy pick to go to the Final Four or whatever that would be. But if you have not done it previous, then you can't change, you know, midstream, because to me that would be an indication to the players that we're panicking. And yes, there's a lot of season left to play, but I don't think you can take more burden on. Like our individual guys say, man, we haven't played to my capability, but what's going to happen when I do? So I think it's a lot of conversation. I think certainly with all the social media attention, it's on a daily basis. Do the players hear it? Yes. Do they ever talk about it? No. And do we as a staff present it to them as we have to live to someone else's expectation? The answer is no.
Okay, thanks. And then, I mean, you just said, you know, about not panicking. I think Eli was one who said it after last game, you know, don't panic, but have that sense of urgency. And Hunter's been telling us, you know, it feels like you guys can't afford, you know, a slip up. You gotta win games down the stretch here, I guess. Yeah, what is that balance between, not feeling like every game's a must win?
Again, I think it goes to the core here, and that is daily improvement. You know, you've all heard Juwan talk about 1%. Well, that has to stay the same. And if anybody is sitting around, players, coaches, support staff, if anybody's sitting around saying, okay, well, we have to get that game and we have to get this game, and if we don't, then we're in a heap of trouble. If anybody's projecting out to what is going to happen on a Sunday in March, we don't know. And really, the only thing that we can influence that would be, did we improve today? Will we play better basketball tomorrow than we did Tuesday night versus Nebraska?
All right, thanks.
Hey, Phil. Have you guys been doing anything different in practice to kind of prepare for Zach Edey and Travion Williams?
Other than prayers? I don't know that it's different. It's the scout team is well prepared. Howard Eisley has had a heck of a week. He had the Nebraska scout. Now he has the Purdue scout. And then think about it. We have 2 days for Penn State and then Purdue again. So Howard is looking a little bit older and a little bit more drawn than he normally would at this time of the year. But, you know, we don't have a 7'4 guy. You know, we have Hunter who's listed at 7'2, but he can't play against himself. So you have to stay conceptual. You have to identify their strengths and attack their weaknesses. And that's, and I hate to be coach cliches, but that's what we're going to do. But there's no, you know, we didn't go out and import Charles Barkley, because that's who Travion Williams, with him in the low post, it's just fascinating how he takes the ball in one hand and he can really, really pass. Edie is a special offensive talent, but you can't replicate it. You can't duplicate it. You have to be really solid on our principles and our concepts for how we are going to guard them and how we're going to attack them.
Phil, one thing players have talked about and coaches have talked about over the last couple of games is making sure you play a full 40 minutes. How do you practice that? How do you get that? Yeah, how do you work on that in practice to make sure it comes through on a game day?
You bring, yeah, it's attention to detail. So if we're out there for an hour and 40 minutes and it slips at the hour and 5 minute mark, you have to bring it out. You have to call attention to it. And you just can't say, well, we'll turn the switch on when we go to Mackey. That's not real. But you can, in practice, you can demand that. If it's a 12-minute segment and there's slippage at minute 9 or 10, then that's the same slippage that you all saw in the second half at Nebraska. We come out strong and then, well, there's slippage. Well, from a coaching point of view, you look at, well, who's on the floor? Are guys tiring? Do I need to make it a longer bench, a quicker subs? But in practice, you can absolutely practice whatever is being asked of these players, hour and 20 minutes, hour and 40 minutes, 2 hours and 10 minutes, that we're going to maximize that opportunity. And then you bring it out to them during the game and say, look, we're just in the back end of practice now. So let's make sure that we can respond physically and mentally.
Hey, Phil, you guys have won four of your last five games. I guess, where have you seen the team make the most progress over the stretch?
Most progress to me is, one, we've made some shots. We've made some timely shots. Now, you walk out of the game the other night and say, holy mackerel, two threes, that's not going to work. But Eli's three obviously was so big. And then having Brandon Johns make a three, so you know, maybe we can get some momentum going with Brandon Johns. And I think the second part is the fact that we've responded. I mean, everybody here watched those games in November and December. We didn't win the Northwestern game in November and December. We didn't win the Nebraska game having to come back in November and December. So we're a little bit mentally tougher. We're a little bit better making some key shots. And that, to me, has been the growth in the four out of five. And as I've said before on this, the calmness with which Juwan approaches this. You know, he didn't panic. He didn't panic when we were 7-7. He's didn't panic today when things maybe got twisted in practice. He stays consistent. And I think these players are feeding off of that.
And you touched on Zach Edey and Travion Williams. I guess just Purdue as a whole, I mean, they're one of the most efficient and high scoring offenses in the nation. Just what stands out about them on that end?
Well, we have obviously an intricate defensive game plan. And I'm going to break the coaching code here and say to you, I actually think our best defense in this game is our offense. We have to score the ball. We just have to score the ball, because you only have so many fingers to put into the holes in the dike. They're going to come because of what you just said. They lead the Big Ten in points per game. They lead the Big Ten in field goal percentage. They have balance across the floor. I mean, it's just unusual when you pop in their stats and say, well, that guy's shooting 41% from three, and Gills is shooting 50% from three. And it's been brought up earlier, they have two low post buckets waiting to happen in Williams and Edie. So I think one of the ways that we can stifle their offense is to score the ball and then go at them. And if you look at the Ohio State game the other day, they had Ohio State dead to rights 15, 16 down. And Ohio State kept coming and kept coming and kept coming and ended up with 80 some points. Well, you know what? If that's what it's going to take, it's going to be the offensive end that leads us to play good defense.
And then I guess just flipping it on the other side, the last three games, you guys' defense, I guess, opponents are averaging, I think it's like 77 points and shooting over 50% combined. Can you put your finger on why teams as of late have been having that type of offensive success against you guys?
Well, I think that in all three games, there's been one consistent, and that we have not controlled the ball. The ball has gotten where they want, where the opponent wants to get it. And if that's the teeth of our defense. And then the second thing is we have just fouled too much in these last three games. Thank you.
Anything else for Coach? Hey, Phil. Yeah. It just speaks to Purdue's, threats that I don't think Jaden Ivett's name has even been mentioned yet. And he's obviously, just electric. As far as the coaching code, whether Eli guards him or now whoever guards him, like, I guess the task that they will face, if you can speak to that from your perspective.
The first thing with him is we have to stop his feet. End to end, he's as fast a guy as we've played all year. And then his creativity in shots at the rim are an issue. They play, their offense plays with such great pace that whoever draws that assignment, and it's going to be everybody that you can think of is going to have an opportunity. We have to make sure that we stop his feet, that when he gets it, he's not able to turn and just go downhill, that in transition, he sees what we would call a wall and not just a clear path to the basket. It is, he really does play, proverbial, his hair on fire. It seems like that's the way he's playing, but his efficiency and also, we can't minimize Matt Painter's offensive mind. I've said before, like, that's been the biggest eye-opening thing for me in the Big Ten is the offensive creativity in this league. And Jaden Ivey is certainly, he benefits in playing in that system. And he also plays off of his teammates well. Travion Williams is a magnet, very willing passer. Both of their point guards, Hunter and Thompson, know how to really put their teammates in great positions. And Sasha's shooting stretches the floor. Gillis stretches the floor, shooting over 50% from three. So I think the number one thing with Ivy is if he's able to just be the roadrunner for 40 minutes, we're in a heap of trouble. Mm-hmm. But if we can stop and make him set his feet, then we'll have a chance to guard him.
Thanks.
Thank you for your time, fellas.